Good morning, church. I greet you and remind you that God's grace and peace are yours this day and forevermore. If you'll stand with me, let's begin our worship with a call to worship. The truly happy person doesn't follow wicked advice, doesn't stand on the rod of sinners, and doesn't sit with the disrespectful. Instead of doing those things, these persons love the Lord's instruction, and they recite God's instruction day and night. Our opening hymn this morning, Jesus Shall Reign. Jesus shall reign where'er the sun does its successive journeys run. His kingdom spread from shore to shore till moon shall wax and wane no more. Let every creature rise and bring honor peculiar to our King. Angels descend with songs again, and earth repeat the loud Amen. Please be seated. Our opening scripture reading comes from the letter called Timothy, St. Paul's writing to Timothy, perhaps, and others, of course. In the opening greeting, we hear these words. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength because he considered me faithful. So he appointed me to ministry, even though I was used to speaking against him, attacking his people, and I was proud. But I wasn't shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and without faith. Our Lord's favor poured all over me, along with the faithfulness and love that are in Christ Jesus. This saying is reliable and deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Oh, and I'm the biggest sinner of all. But this is why I was shown mercy, so that Christ Jesus could show his endless patience to me first of all. So I'm an example for those who are going to believe in him for eternal life. Now, to the King of the ages and to the immortal, invisible, and only God, may honor and glory be given to him forever and always. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Tell me the stories of Jesus I love to hear. Things I would ask him to tell me if he were here. Scenes by the wayside, tales of the sea. Stories of Jesus, tell them to me. All right. Are you all feeling young at heart this morning? Young at heart. I didn't say young in body, right? All right. You all know what that is, right? Flashlight. And if you hold a flashlight above us, pretty soon we get shadows. I can even play, let's see, make a picky shadow. There we go. Make it look like a snout of a pig. And well, anyway. Yeah, animal shadows, right? A lot of fun. Did you ever play that game with one another as little kids, you know, where you step on each other's shadow on a sunny day, right? Kind of run around each other and, no, nobody played that? Ah, maybe I was extremely crazy or imaginative or something, I don't know. Or you try to run away from a shadow, right? I always liked pulling that one on a little three-year-old or something. Oh, what's that dark thing? Get away from it, you know, kind of thing, right? And the fun thing then is to have a conversation about, you know, well, you can't really get rid of your shadow, can you? It's always there. Always there. And so as I was thinking about the scripture this morning that St. Paul writes to 1 Timothy, he kind of confesses this, right? He confesses that, well, you know, he's thankful, but when you hear about his thankfulness, he's thankful for strength. And how does that strength come? Well, that strength comes because, well, he's got a shadow. You know, he's got things that have happened in his life he's not too terribly proud of, right? In fact, he says, you know, that at one time he was attacking his people. He was against Jesus. He was attacking the people of Jesus. And he was a proud man, right? And in that pride and in that behavior, now that's become a shadow for him as he now knows Jesus and realizes his behavior before. And yet he still has the memory, doesn't he, of those days. And we all do. We all do things that we're not proud of, things that cause us maybe a little bit of shame. We all do things that we wish we could take back almost the instant sometime that we do them. And it becomes like a shadow for us. We just can't get away from it. Now, at the same time, Paul doesn't just talk about that, because remember, he starts out by saying he's thankful for strength, strength that's come through him seeing his shadow, right? Him seeing the errors of his life. And then he says, our Lord's favor poured all over me, poured all over me with faithfulness and love that are in Christ Jesus. That's when he realized that in spite of the fact that he's got a dark shadow, right? In spite of the fact that these things have been part of his life, he's been shown mercy. He's been shown forgiveness. God's grace has let him know he doesn't have to live in that darkness. In fact, it's not just about living in the darkness, it's about being the darkness. Because sometimes when we make a goof up, I mean a real bad goof up, what do we say to ourselves? I did a bad thing, or I am bad? Ooh, I think it's the second thing too often we say to ourselves, right? I am bad, and God didn't make junk. We're not that, right? We're good stuff. But when we get caught in the shadow, we take upon ourselves the bad things we do as our own identity. The saying is reliable and deserves full acceptance, then he says. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. When we receive this gift of forgiveness, Now, of course, it opens up doors. But he confesses, I'm the biggest sinner of all. Well, I imagine there are times when we all feel that way, right? And maybe by simply confessing that, we begin a new life in a new way just with that reality. Well, that's perhaps enough for now, but at least it leaves Paul to praying. Did you catch that prayer? Isn't it wonderful? Now, he says, now to the King of ages, to the immortal, the invisible, and only God, may honor and glory be given to him forever and always. Amen. Right? Wonderful prayer. May it be our prayer this day. Thanks be to God. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. May I invite us to be in prayer together. May the Lord be with you. Gracious Lord, we do give you thanks and praise for your presence with us this day. Lord, there are answered prayers in our midst. And yet, Lord, at the same time, as we know your presence, maybe it softens our hearts as we know your presence, but we see need. We pray for friends or neighbors. Sometimes those prayers are spoken aloud with names, or sometimes not. Sometimes, Lord, just from the silence of our hearts, there are those unspoken things that you know, because you know our hearts and minds. Lord, as we pray for one another, as we pray for family, friends, acquaintances, Lord, community members, we just know that you're caring for all matters under heaven. And Lord, as we listen even to the evening news, perhaps, or as we turn our attention to what's going on beyond our community and the world around us, Lord, sometimes it's really easy to think to ourselves, oh, we'll just shut it off. It's all bad stuff. But Lord, in the midst of the things that are hard to watch, in the midst of the news that's sometimes just hard to pay attention to because it just seems so awful. Lord God, you're at work. There are first responders. There are people who are volunteering their time. There are people who are going in harm's way. There are soldiers who are responding, Lord, to orders to bring peace. Lord, there are all kinds of ways that you are at work. So let us not be shy, Lord, to pay attention to the suffering of the world. For as we look into the face of suffering, surely you're there. As we look into the face of need, Lord, where there is hunger and disaster, surely you're there. As we look at these matters under heavens all around, Lord, we can certainly be praying praise and thanksgiving for how you are always present. For these things, Lord, we offer to you as our morning prayer in thanksgiving through Jesus Christ. Amen. If you'll stand with me, let's continue our praise as we make our morning offerings to God. Praise God from Please be seated. Our second scripture reading this morning comes from the Old Testament book of Samuel, 2 Samuel this time, as I've been making my way through some of these Old Testament readings this summer, lifting up those servants of God whom we can still learn something from and admire and hope to be, you know, hope to gain the qualities that God has given to them. We hear once again about King David. Last week's reading was about this young boy who was anointed and the quality that he surely had in common with the very first king of the Israelites, you know, the quality of being humble. But for David, it seemed as if he not only had the quality of being humble needed for a king, but he also had the ability to somehow hold on to the humility, right? Sometimes, and I know I get this way, right? One moment I think I'm humble, the next minute I'm shooting my mouth off and my head's this fat, right? But somehow David has especially received the quality from God where he's not only filled with humility, but he has the skill of staying close to God so that when things do go wrong, when he commits the sin, he takes responsibility for it. He doesn't blame others, doesn't blame the system, but he faces it head on. He's able somehow to hold fast to the humility. Well, we hear this morning in the scripture reading, one of those moments that could have easily gone to his head. Let's hear it. When the king was settled in his palace and the Lord had given him rest from all his surrounding enemies, the king then said to the prophet Nathan, Hey, look, I'm living in a cedar palace, but God's chest is housed in a tent. Well, then Nathan said to the king, go ahead and do whatever you're thinking, because, well, the Lord is with you. But that very night, the Lord's word then came to Nathan, go to my servant David and tell him, this is what the Lord says. You are not the one to build the temple for me to live in. In fact, I haven't lived in a temple from the day I brought Israel out of Egypt until now. Instead, I have been traveling around in a tent and in a dwelling place. Throughout my traveling around with the Israelites, did I ever ask any Israel's tribal leaders I appointed to shepherd my people, why haven't you built me a cedar temple? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. From where you're seated, if you'll join me, let's sing together. God will take care of you. Be not dismayed, whate'er betide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He
take care of you. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. Lean, weary one, upon his breast, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you.
Ah, that's a nice tune. Enjoy singing that. But the words are wonderful too, aren't they? God will take care of you. I mean, similar to Jesus' last words, right? When Jesus ascended to heaven in those last moments as Jesus had been with his disciples in the resurrection, and when he was taken up to heavens, what was among his last words? I'll be with you always. God is there caring for us. Now here's the issue, right? We might not be spending enough time internalizing that truth. If it's true, right, which we believe it is, it's one of our most fundamental doctrines of the faith, that God is always there with us, right? If we were spending enough time internalizing that, and that was just part of our DNA, one of the things we'd always be doing is faithfully serving God, right? However, I find myself still giving in to temptations, still, you know, creating shadows in my life. Where's that come from? Well, I think maybe I'm still not spending enough time internalizing one of the most fundamental truths of our faith. Who is God? What does God desire from me? That I just, you know, continually go to God again and again and again. Oh, God, do this for me. Oh, God, do that for me. Oh, fix this. Oh, take care of that. Right? God must get worn out. When are we all ever asking God, how can we serve you? David, King David, yeah, you hear me talk about him having this wonderful gift of humility, but it expresses itself again and again and again in ways that show us that he's been able to internalize this humility. It's become part of who he is, right? This morning's scripture tells us that in so many ways. Let's hear some of it again. It begins in chapter 7 of 2 Samuel. Well, when the king was settled in his palace, by now, in order for there to be a palace, right? Because remember, he's built what initially is the city of David. It becomes Jerusalem after a fashion. But he's built the city. He's unified the 12 tribes so that now they're one nation. And they're not just any nation, right? Again, the scripture gives us a hint at this. When the king was settled in his palace and the Lord had given him rest from all his surrounding enemies, meaning physically, all those nations that used to be a threat are no threat anymore under his reign, right? He's put them in their place, showed them, don't mess with this neighbor, right? And so as he's there, in this time period of, what would you call it, success? maybe this time where maybe the economy's running good, right? We like hearing about that. And this time of prosperity where he's got now a palace to live in? I don't know about you, but I'm afraid if that were me, like I said, this fat head that I know I can get, I'd probably have one about then. But not David. When he's sitting around thinking about how things have gone, what's going on in his mind? Instead, right, of having this fat head, he calls for his prophet Nathan, right? And he says, hey, look, I'm living in a cedar palace, but God's chest, God, the presence of God, this symbol that we have for the presence of God, they had a chest, right? What they referred to as the Ark of the Covenant. And they believe this ark, which contained the tablets given by Moses, right, contained the law. Probably a few other artifacts in there, right? We don't know. They don't tell about that as much. But we know there's certain decorations on the outside, and then when they worshipped, you know, this chest with the centerpiece of the worship as the symbol of God, just like we would have the cross, right, in those days. He's mindful that this chest, this lowly device that symbolizes God in their presence, this God who never goes away, is still in a tent while he's in a palace. Do you hear his humility? And rather than going off the deep end and asking for more power, right, and asking for more trouble, because that's usually when you ask for power what you get, he's thinking about what he can do for God. He's thinking about what he can do for God. Who is this God who then says to David through Nathan, the prophet, who is this God who says, nope, you're not the one to build, right? You're not the one to build the temple. I love that passage. That very night, the Lord's words came to Nathan, go to my servant David and tell him, this is what the Lord says, you are not the one to build the temple for me to live in. Well, why not? My gosh, with humility, it's not going to go to his head, obviously, right? But why not? Why can't he build this temple? What's going on? Well, for that answer, we might have to flip to, again, to other history books, right, that we can find in the Bible. In 1 Chronicles, in the 22nd chapter, in verse 6, we hear these words. Now, these words are David's words at the very end of his life. So we have to, you know, fast forward lots of years. He's had children by this time. He's had wives. Yeah, okay, there was polygamy in those days. All right. His wealth is even greater. His control over the powers of the armies and military might is even greater. So we fast forward to the end of his life, and he's explaining to one of his sons with these words. David sent for his son Solomon, and he instructed him to build a temple for the Lord, the God of Israel. And David said to Solomon, My son, I had intended to build a temple for the name of the Lord my God. But the Lord told me, you've shed much blood and waged great wars. You won't build a temple for my name because, well, you've spilled so much blood on the ground before me. Oh, this is why he's not to build the temple. Now think about this. Think about this. We know it's true because we can read it in various places in Scripture, right? We read about it in Kings and in Samuel, and we read about it again in Chronicles, that when David did go to war, when David did have to use military might, there were the innocents. I mean, even today we have this issue, right? What do we call it? There's a name for it. There's a phrase for it, actually. Collateral damage, right? David had blood on his hands. He was the warrior king. He was the military genius that God needed to pull a nation together, to build a nation. But that didn't make him innocent, did it? And would you have a place of worship if you were God, made out of military might? Made out of blood on our hands? I mean, really? Even today, as Methodists, we try to shy away from this kind of stuff. We have a wonderful mechanism, right? It's actually through our clergy, now clergy and laity, because people who are laypersons, who are full-time employees of the church, also can participate in the pension program. And in the pension program, it's in the top 10 largest pension programs in the country. So the amount of money they have invested is huge. Oh my gosh, right? It's huge. And what do they do with that money? Well, I can tell you what they don't do with it. They don't invest in anything that smacks of tobacco. They don't invest in anything of it that has anything to do with alcohol, right? Or any other substance that's abused. They don't invest in military equipment, right? You won't find them sending money to Lima for the Lima tank factory, right? It just doesn't happen. Because again, the same issue is at hand, right? Do we want our mission, do we want our ministry built upon bloody hands? Even David wasn't allowed to do that. Now, how do you suppose David reacted? We'll go back to that moment when Nathan brings him the news the next morning over morning coffee, right? And Nathan comes in, maybe with a long look on his face, wondering, oh, how's the king going to react when I tell him God said no, right? Now, I don't know about you. Again, I'm not past that behavior that I started out with when I was 2. I want to do it, right? I still have my tantrums. Now, they look different, probably. They sound different. My wife knows my tantrums. She'll tell me right away, now cut it out. Stop pouting. You know, because when you really plan for something, when you really, really are looking forward to something, and then all of a sudden you can't do it. You're told, no, we can't do that. I mean, you know, so what kind of a reaction over something so huge was King David going to have when the prophet Nathan came in? I mean, nobody liked prophets, right? This is why they were stoned and killed so frequently. Nobody wanted to hear what they had to say. But when Nathan came in, right, we don't have the immediate reaction recorded, but again, we can kind of read between the lines. Because what we see instead is the recording of David's reaction, what he did rather than what he said. And what he did was, is rather than stomping his feet and sulk for 3 weeks, right, what he did was is start immediately collecting supplies, started immediately setting aside royal treasury so that the next generation, right, would be able to build the temple long before he knew it was going to be his son Solomon, right? So rather than be upset, he takes responsibility he was bound to be a little discouraged. I mean, I would grant that. He was human after all. He was bound to be a little sad about it. But in the end, this great God that he could do something for, well, if he wasn't going to actually oversee it and be able to worship it in one day, at least that he could do is contribute toward it, which he does. He takes responsibility for what otherwise might be horrible behavior. David, if you will, is filled with what we might call graceful humility. He so knows the grace of God in his life, right, that maybe that is what helps him remain humble. Maybe that is what helps him know that he dare not go out to war without first consulting God. That he dare not, you know, do a lot of things without consulting God. Although, we know he slips too, right? Because fast forward just a few pages from where I read out of Samuel chapter 7, by the time you get into chapter 11 and 12 and 13, what are we reading about? Oh, when David got bored and didn't go out to war when he should have and spied a naked woman across the way because he was on the palace roof, right, which oversaw the whole city, and then sent for her and, oh, well, that's another story, another sermon, another time, but oh, right? So it's not that he was perfect. Being humble doesn't mean you do everything right. What it means is you take responsibility for what you do wrong. And by taking responsibility for those horrible things, you step out of your own shadow. You step out of those things that otherwise would weigh you down with guilt and shame and grief. We want to teach this to our kids, don't we? But how? I stumbled across some really sound advice from a school teacher. Sherry Wolfert is the name online. And she writes to parents, she writes to other teachers, and she suggests this. She says, whether it's a game of Candyland or soccer or an academic quiz bowl, our children need to know how to win and to lose gracefully. I mean, that's David, right? He didn't win every battle. There were a few that were pretty bloody and pretty bad, and God would tell him why, right? But he would win the victory in the end because he remained with God. He remained in grace. So she knows this. Our children need to know how to win and lose gracefully. We want our children to succeed, but sometimes we ourselves get tangled up in the competition, and we forget that winning doesn't make you a champion, and losing doesn't make you a failure, right? We are not the end result of our behavior. That's that whole shadow thing. And then she just simply summarizes, here are some focus points for helping kids to win and lose. And what she talks about is, how do we keep in balance, right? Competition is a good thing, right? Doing the kinds of things David did, which was, in his case, especially as a king, the competition was with other nations around, competition for the world markets, competition for, security, competition for all kinds of things. But that doesn't need to go to our heads, nor does it, if there's a failure in case, if there's a lost battle, nor does it need to draw us down and make us somehow unable to continue to do God's will. Graceful humility is just recognizing that in spite of our failures even, what did we say in the very beginning? God doesn't leave us. God doesn't go away. And in the gospel news of Jesus Christ, more than that, God says, I forgive you, right? Now back to that message in 1 Timothy. If there's anybody who maybe shouldn't have been forgiven, it was Saul. But he's the one that says, hey, I become the example then. There's probably nobody done anything worse against Jesus Christ than me. And yet now I can testify about the greatest gift of all, forgiveness. Now it's fun how when you learn some of these pieces of wisdom, some of this truth, that you can find it in lots of places. In New York City a few years ago, there was a spiritual guru that died. He wasn't a Christian spiritualist. He was an Eastern Indian spiritualist, if you will. He brought with him, when he immigrated to America, his Eastern meditative traditions. And he became a story writer. And his whole life was about teaching spiritual truths. And what's interesting is oftentimes, around the world, we can hear common truths like what we're talking about this morning with graceful humility. We can find them in other places. And so I just want to share with you one of his stories. He starts out this way. A cosmic god had a horse. Of course, Eastern tradition, right? Gods. Well, all right, but looking past that, we get to the same truth. A cosmic god had a horse. The horse was beautiful, right? It was absolutely beautiful, and it also had lots of good qualities. But, somehow this horse wasn't quite satisfied. It wanted to be more perfect in every way. It wanted to become beauty unparalleled, right? So one day, it said to the cosmic god, I'm more than ready, one day the cosmic god said to the horse, I'm more than ready to make you beautiful, because the cosmic god knew of the desires of this beautiful horse. So just tell me, in what way do you want to be changed? And so the horse is delighted, right? The horse is going to become beauty unparalleled. And so the horse is ready for this. The horse says, well, if you made my neck a little bit longer, right, the upper part of my body would certainly be more pleasing to look at, and the beauty would be enhanced. And if you made my legs just a little bit longer and perhaps a little bit thinner, not only would that help with a lower beauty of my body, but it would also, enable my qualities of racing to be even better. Well, as soon as that was, described to the cosmic god, poof, a camel appeared. And the horse said, no, not that. That's not what I had in mind. Well, a longer neck and longer, thinner legs, what more do you want? Well, of course, then at that point, the horse just went off the deep end. There's no beauty in a camel, my goodness. That ugly beast, nobody pays attention to them. I asked to be more beautiful. I asked to be, greater in quality, and so that more people would look upon the beauty and think of you. Well, that's not exactly how the first request came across. And finally, when the horse runs out of words and just doesn't know what to complain about more, the cosmic god says this: never try to achieve or receive more than I have given you. If you want to lead a desire life, then at every moment you will want more and more and more and more. If you want to lead a desire life, you will have no idea what outcome will come. Each thing in creation has its own qualities. The camel is not as beautiful, perhaps, as you are in your way, but it carries heavy loads and has a tremendous sense of responsibility. It has its own beauty. Nice story, but I hear David in that. Do you? Did you catch that? The horse, who wants to be perfect in every way, who wants to be beauty unparalleled, that could have been David, right? Wants a successful king, once a palace was built, could have ignored the word from the prophet, you know, stone him like other kings eventually would stone prophets, get rid of them. I mean, Saul chased after Samuel when pretty soon he didn't like what Samuel was saying, so Samuel had to flee for his life. I mean, this is nothing new, but David could have chosen to get rid of Nathan, never mind the advice, and go ahead and build this fabulous palace where he'd make maybe even a throne for himself inside the place of worshiping God, and maybe even be tempted, okay, well, you're passing by the throne, be sure and bow to me on the way to bowing to God. Sound familiar? Sometimes we mix up our nationalism and God's place in the universe. Yeah, being humble is not easy. It can really get out of hand. But fortunately for the Israelites, God's servant David does a pretty good job of managing this most of the time. And when the word no comes, which sometimes is every bit as important as the word yes from God, David is able to perhaps bite his tongue, not say anything because the scripture doesn't really tell us that he does, let it mull around in his mind and heart a bit, and then still come back with a response to serve God. It's nice to sing the song, God will take care of me. God will take care of us. But you know where real joy comes from is when we're so gracefully filled that we become servants of graceful humility. Where the real joy comes from is when we give back to God, just as David does again and again and again. As God's children filled with grace, let us know that as we depart from this table, life's not going to go according to plan. We're not going to behave in ways that we're always going to be mindful of. And so with that, having been filled with His grace, may we fall on our knees at any time and in any place and pray just as we pray now, as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If you'll stand with me, let's share together in our closing hymn.
To the Lord's anointed, great David's greater son. Hail in the time appointed, his reign on earth begun. He comes to break oppression, to set the captive free, to take away transgression, and rule in equity. To him prayers are ceasing, and daily vows ascend. His kingdom still increasing, a kingdom without end. The tide of time shall never his covenant remove. His name shall stand forever, that name to us is love.
So I send you forth, dear brothers and sisters, to live gracefully, filled by God's grace, not because we're good at doing anything, but filled with grace enough to be gracefully humble before God, that you might serve him in all joy. Amen.